want to introduce, because everybody knows, John Wharton. John.
And he told me that, and it really got me kind of scared and worried. But anyway, I do appreciate this opportunity. I think you have given me way too much time to go through what I want to talk about, but maybe we'll have some time for some questions afterwards. I've got just but one slide up here, and take a look at it. These are the skills needed by business and industry that have been reported to us. I was at a meeting a month or so ago that this was a survey of our business and industry leaders in this surrounding area. And these are the things that they said they needed, they wanted from an employee. Good communication skills, good work ethics, critical thinking skills, computer skills, be able to pass a drug test, the ability to listen, a team player, has initiative, has math skills, and to be on time. I'm going to leave this up here as we kind of talk about some of the things that I have to discuss. And I want you to kind of think about where you learned these skills, where you developed these skills, and maybe compare that to where our kids today are learning these skills and what they, where are they getting this. So, as Mr. Carr mentioned, surely in 2 years we've accomplished something. Appreciate that. So anyway, we'll think about that. And he did ask me to speak on that a little bit, and then talk about where we may be going in the future. Just on the past 2 years, I guess since I've been here, I think my first and initial goal and priority was to build relationships and hopefully gain your trust. That was, in my mind, a main priority. It was never my goal, and for that matter, our board's goal for me to come in and make a bunch of quick changes and be one of these short-time superintendents to come in and makes everybody mad and they're ready to run them off a couple of years. Hopefully that's not the case, because we love it here. And we want to make sure that all of our students have the best educational opportunities that we can possibly give them. Our goal has been to continue to expand the high level of expectation, the high level of education that you, the community, expects and demands. And in order for us to do that, I believe wholeheartedly the first step in that is to establish relationships in the community. And so hopefully that is what we try to do on a daily basis. Hopefully we're accomplishing that. But academically, tangibly, what have we accomplished in the past couple of years? And this is just a high school, and it's certainly not anything that is reflective of me. They do a tremendous job over there. Last year, they had over $3 million in scholarships that was accepted. This year, we're on pace to be over around that $2 million, a little over $2 million this year. Last year, we had 55 students that had a 30 or higher on their ACT. This year we're at 44. AP awards, 18 AP scholar awards with a 3 or higher on their AP exams, 5 AP scholar with honor awards, average score of at least 3.25, and scores of 3 on at least 4 or more exams, 6 AP scholars with a distinction of 3.5, and at least a 3 on 5 or more tests, and 123 students passed the AP exam. And I think that speaks volumes about our AP program. And while we're talking about the AP program, I don't know if we have anybody from Albemarle in here, but I need to take this opportunity to thank them publicly for their support and their continued support of our AP program. Concurrent enrollment with SAU Tech, there's 178 students with SAU, and then 394 with SAU Tech, 394 for the fall, and then 455 for the spring semester. Our students are able to enroll in these classes, you know, right now at no cost, you know, to them. Their tuition is all scholarship, and they receive college or vocational credit for that. So that is that is all the accolades we like to brag about, we like to boast about, and we like to promote the good things that are happening in our schools. The reality is we have too many kids that are not a part of this statistic, that are not achieving successfully academically. They're not leaving with these skills that you said that we want. And we don't talk about these kids much because you know they're not like what we like to promote. But the truth is that they're there, and we need to do a better job of reaching those kids and doing whatever we can to make them graduate with these skills and to make them academically successful. So how do we do that? We're just finishing up our strategic plan, and I think you'll see that this marries right into the things that we're talking about in our strategic plan. And certainly, we don't have time to go through all that. There were too many actions, and it was too detailed and in depth to do in this short time. But I do want to give a brief overview of that. We have completed that this spring. There were about 65 staff, students, and community members involved in that process. They spent countless of hours working and developing this plan. It is ambitious, there is no doubt, but it's achievable. And at the end of the day, I believe it will empower us to provide a world-class education that will not only accomplish these skills, but beyond. And just to begin with, the strategic plan focused on three areas: academic performance, learning environment, and efficiency. I'll kind of talk about each one of those just briefly. And again, I'm not going to go over each one of the actions that were developed in that, but just kind of give you an idea of the focus areas on that. Academic performance, aligning curriculum, we currently do that. We work on that every year, eliminating the gaps, cross-curricular planning, making sure that our curriculum is aligned vertically as well as horizontally. Instructional strategies, we review that every year. Response to intervention, ACT prep type classes, student-centered teaching strategies, not necessarily a sit and get that is traditional. And I would have, over at the junior high this year, they've implemented a new program that has many of these strategies that's what we're talking about. And we had a couple of our representatives, and Senator Malik and Representative Fielding came, as well as some of the schools from the surrounding area, and we had several visitors that came and were interested in looking at what we were doing in the junior high. Now, I'll just give you a brief example of one class that we walked into. So we walk in there. First of all, I'm just going to back up. We spent a good amount of money on buying some new desks in the junior high this past year. And they're this trapezoid shapes, and I love them. They're great. You can set them individually, and they're great. Plenty of room for one student. You can butt them up against each other, and they're great for paired. You can put them in almost any configuration that you want to, and kids are able to work together in that set. It's interesting. So I walk in there, keeping in mind we just spent a good amount of money on this desk. It's a math class, and teachers walking around facilitating. We're not up here lecturing. We're walking around facilitating what we like to see. Kids are in a group, three, four, five to a group, and they're all talking to each other. They're developing communication skills. They're working together as a team. They're developing critical thinking skills, and they're working on their math skills. They've got these Expo markers, and they're writing all these problems out on their desk. These brand new desks that we've got. There's parentheses everywhere, and apparently they're in literacy class too, because all these letters are there with these math problems, and which is a little beyond me. I have to bite my tongue a little bit, because we have our representatives and our senators there. I said, it's okay, I'm sorry, real clean. It's a different time is what I'm getting at, and our kids learn differently. They're engaged, and they had a different instructional strategy than what they were used to getting, and they were involved in the lesson. Kids were in there working together, and I'm telling you, it was exciting. It see. Educational experiences for kids. Partnerships with SAU, they have, participating in science fair, the writing fair, kids college. We need to have more participation from our kids in that, and we intend to do that. Field trips, we tend to get away from field trips. There's been so much emphasis on, testing. We have to get all this stuff. We're testing, and we forget the importance of educational experiences for kids. So that was something that was important for us to try to incorporate back into the educational process. Community speakers, clubs. Another thing that came out of this area that incorporated this financial literacy into the curriculum. We have some economic classes, but I'll tell you a quick story. I have lunch with a group of kids each month. We call it Soup with the Soup, and it's a fun time. We make them some homemade soup, and it's their opportunity to get to know me, and I get to know them a little better. And there are no barriers. They can tell me whatever they want to. Don't hold it against them. It doesn't leave that room. It's their opportunity to voice to me what they think we should do, what we should do better, what we do well, what they wish they had, opportunities that they wish they had come to school. It's a great conversation. And this last month, one of them said, I don't know, we were talking about, somebody asked a question about that led into a conversation about finances, and said, we need a life class. I don't know anything about what you're just talking about. I don't even know how to write a check. We need a life class. All these things that we're going to have to learn to do, when we graduate next month, I don't know how to do them, just a life class. So, you get great ideas from kids. And, of course, professional development. The learning environment, the focus in these areas were signage around campus for easier accessibility. A great example of this, if you're not familiar with Magnolia, everybody know where the old superintendent's office is? Did we know that the registrar's office is inside the old superintendent's office? So if you come to town to register your kids, you're supposed to go to the old superintendent's office, but there's really nothing that identifies that the registrar is in the old superintendent's office, or it's the annex now. So there's no sign. It's a great form. So that was what they were talking about with easier identification of buildings and where things are around the campus. Safety, updated security system and cameras. A drop-off lane at the east side. Currently, they're just lined up there in the street, and that traffic is pretty well blocked. If you've ever tried to pick up kids in the afternoon or drop them off in the morning. The other campuses, we have a nice drop-off lane that allows traffic to continue to flow. An alternative learning environment. We currently have one of those, but there was some talk about making that a little better program. One-to-one laptops for kids. We are very close to being there. We're not far off. Possibly could get there this year. It may extend on into next year. I think the last time I spoke with y'all, we talked about the importance of the free and reduced money, NSL funds, and we reached that 70%. This will be our third year entering the third year to get that full funding, and all the computers that we bought, the majority of the computers that we bought the past 2 years has been a direct result of us being able to increase our NSLA funds. So that is a good thing, has been a good thing, and we'll continue to buy laptops with those funds. Restructure our grade configuration with a ninth grade academy, which means moving our ninth graders over to the senior high campus, which would require a building of their own. Ninth graders are a different species. They really don't fit in well anywhere. But I'm not sure that with 12-year-olds is the most appropriate place. The gap between 12 and 15-year-olds seems to be much broader than between 15 and 18. There are pros and cons to that, and we're going to spend the next stakeholders easier access to information within our website, social media, et cetera. Workforce needs within our community, kind of going back to some of these things, is also are there other career opportunities that we need to offer within our school? Currently, we're adding another third ag teacher, going back to where we had several years ago. I think that will get more kids involved in FFA and some of those activities. And any of you that have been involved in FFA and AGRI know that it develops nearly every one of these kids. Kids that are involved in FFA or employers like to see that on their resume. They know the benefits of it. Assessment, we're hopefully leaving an era in education where there's been such emphasis on education. So we need to really look at the assessments we're giving. Why are we giving them? And what are we doing with the data after we get it? So we will be looking at that. Efficiency. Focus, the third area, the last area. Focus in these areas, recognition, incentives for students and teachers alike, acknowledging success, promoting us. We can certainly do a better job of recognition of teachers and students for their successes. Community partnerships, maintenance of facilities. Apparently, these flat roofs, and I don't understand the physics of it real well, but apparently flat roofs don't drain. I'm not sure. I know, we have one slope that I can think of, one slope roof in our campus, and that I know of, it doesn't leak. So I don't know if it's a coincidence or not, but we certainly have some roofing issues that we need to address, and we're doing that now, and we'll continue to do that. Parking lots throughout the district. The paving, apparently you have to update that, occasionally, and we need to continue to expand our parking and begin to resurface some of the parking that we currently have. I mentioned the ninth grade academy. That would take a building to house those students. Performing arts building, our band and choir, Mr. Carr, tremendously successful programs. Anytime they perform in front of the community, parents, it's difficult to see them. They're performing, the stage is small, and so they either can't get everybody up there, or they're packed so closely it's hard to tell what's going on up there. Anytime the choir or band perform for a competition, they have to go to a different town that has the facilities to house them. They eat in their restaurants and stay in their hotels. Think that would be an opportunity to get some people into Magnolia. The other thing that we don't do a whole lot of that I find interesting, and I love this about Magnolia. There's the art center. We have lots of drama opportunities. The college, they have lots of the performing arts, and I think we're missing the boat a little bit there with our drama department. We need to do a better job of having that as an option for our kids to get involved in drama in our schools. So the other thing is an aquatic center. Our kids have experienced tremendous success in this area, and there is opportunity to expand that program even more. So what do we have? How does all this tie together? It's about getting kids involved. Activities. When you think about where this is developed, yes, in the classroom. I learned a lot of these things at home, and working, and that's where I learned a lot of these skills, and I'm sure yours the same way. But where do you learn these elsewhere? Being a part of something greater than yourself. You learn it being a part of the band. Do you think Mr. Stewart will allow you to be a part of the band that if you weren't on time, you're not going to be there? Same thing with our choir. Any of the sports, you've got to communicate. They require you to have a good work ethic. You have to think band. to answer your question, we can't do this without support. And I also realize that right now is not the time to ask for it. You know, I understand that. But there will come a time when we're going to have to ask for your support to do some of the things that we're asking to do. Because we can't accomplish all of these things without that. Until then, we're going to move forward. We're going to accomplish the things that we can do, and we're going to work hard to implement these things that we've identified within the community. You know, the district has a very long history of being extremely frugal with its money, and that is to compliment the board and their work and their expectations, you know, on the superintendent, and we're going to continue to operate that way. The last thing I wanted to talk to you really a little bit, kind of the direction that, and Darryl and I talked about this a little bit earlier, the direction of school in the future. School choice is going to play a huge factor, I think, in education in the future. It's being driven by big business within the state, and that seems to be the direction that we want, so, or the state wants. So that is a big impact. I'm not opposed to school choice. Don't mind saying that. I think competition is good, and I think it makes us be a better school district. What it does do is that it forces us to provide educational opportunities that are more desirable than the surrounding schools. Now, currently, we have schools that do not participate in school choice, claiming, you know, desegregation cases that are older cases. There's been some recent litigation in the Delta that kind of thinks that may not be an option in the future. So we'll see right now, but right now, you know, if you have old desegregation cases, you can't opt out of school choice. It makes us focus on educational experiences, course offerings, activities. The more activities that we can provide for our kids, the more appealing we are to kids. Same thing with the educational activities. You know, our AP program, I'm just amazed by it. It's not the same having AP courses online as it is sitting in the classroom and having an AP teacher right there in front of you. It's not the same. You know, you can offer whatever courses you want to, you know, online and through distance learning, but it's not the same as having a face-to-face contact with teachers. I mentioned activities, band, choir, you know, trap, FFA. We'd like to incorporate more drama to get more kids involved. If we have 80% of our kids involved in an activity, that means that we've got about 126 kids walking around our high school campus that aren't involved in anything. And that's too many. While 80% is a high number, that means that 126 kids are just walking around that aren't involved in anything whatsoever. And that's, we've got to do a better job of that. Our goal is to have 100% of our kids involved in something. And I understand that you know, circumstances may not allow, you know, for every kid, but we need to recruit. We can find something that our kids can do and get them involved that's going to help build these skills right here. Marketing is another thing that is, I think, a phase that has not necessarily been something that schools have had to do in the past to market themselves, to get themselves out there, to promote their brand. And there's but one school that always comes into my mind, you know, thinking about that. And we've got a scrapper in here now. But, you know, when you look at, you know, what Nashville does and how they promote themselves, their brand, they brand themselves as well as any school in the state, and do a phenomenal job of that. It's the same thing as a business. It's the same thing as advertisement, you know, for your business and bringing people in. We've got to really focus some attention on branding ourselves, marketing ourselves, letting people in the community, letting people in the surrounding areas know what we do well, what we have to offer, what we can do to make your child's educational experience better. And so that's kind of where I see us going in the future. And that's where we are. Absolutely.
I got two more years of testing.
That's right. I'll be happy to answer any questions that you have. We're right on time, I guess. Yes, sir.
That be on time reminds me of this young man who went to work for the company, and he was always late. And one day, his boss told him, said, son, I want you to, in the morning, to jump out of bed enthusiastically and be enthusiastic to get here on time. Up the next morning, he was 2 hours late. And the guy said, what happened? You're supposed to be here on time. He said, well, you told me to be enthusiastic when I got up. He said, I got out of bed, I was enthusiastic, I shaved and showered enthusiastic. He said, I kissed my wife enthusiastically, and that's why I'm 2 hours late.
Goes back to being frugal, you know, and the board managing that, and so anyway, we will certainly have that discussion in the future, and certainly provide, you know, the information that you need to make decisions for you. So, are there any other questions?
What would the aquatic center do for the school as far as?
You know, we envision that as being a partnership with SAU and the city, you know, and right now our kids are going to SAU. To practice and from my understanding, and they've been very successful without them, but you know, I don't even think they have starting blocks over there, you know, for them to practice. There is opportunity to grow that program, you know, and I think that would be a tool to help get more kids involved in that. Obviously, you know, during our Dolphin team in the summer is phenomenal, and when you go out there and see how many kids are out there at our, you know, the city's, you know, park. It's full, and it's really neat to see. It's just an area for us to grow, but also a place that we can get more people to come to Magnolia, you know, and stay in our. And the same thing with the performing arts. It's going to bring people here.
What about soccer?
You know, we get. Some of our conversation with kids, we get that conversation occasionally. We don't have a lot of demand about it. We don't have, you know, a lot of requests for it, but we occasionally get a request to do that. And, you know, I know we have the Boys and Girls Club has a soccer program there. And I think the success of a high school program is a strong youth program, and I think that's where it starts. But we do get that request occasionally. Thank you.